And many thanks for this very flattering introduction. And can I say how grateful I am for the invitation to come here? This promises to be a fascinating meeting. I will, at the end of my talk, discuss an unknown connection between Viktor, Hess and Dublin, which I think may be of some interest to you. My job here really is to set the scene and to discuss why, 100 years on, we are still trying to solve the mystery that Viktor has discovered. We have to imagine ourselves back at the turn of the last century, around 1900, 1910. And for a physicist, these must have been extraordinarily exciting times. I don't think we can really imagine how startling it was to see the old physics crumble and obviously an entirely new range of possibilities opening up. It began, of course, with the discovery by Röntgen of X-rays in 1895, rapidly followed by Becquerel's discovery of radioactivity in 1896, the electron by J.J. Thomson, 1897. We tend, in retrospect, to simplify things. We know the answers, and it looks much easier to us now than it was then. So we shouldn't forget that there were also irrvega and mistakes. So, for example, there was a lot of excitement in 1903 when the French physicist Poellau announced the discovery of a totally new, unexpected radiation, which he called, after his university in Nancy, the N-rays. Great deal of interest, a lot of excitement. A lot of people ruined their reputation by what was the equivalent of cold fusion. It turned out to be a physiological effect, not physics at all. 1905, of course, we celebrated a few years ago, was the Annus Mirabilis, where Einstein published three papers in 1 year, any one of which would have established his reputation. Photoelectric effect, the special relativity, the Brownian motion paper. Astonishing, really, that three such papers would appear in one journal in 1 year. So this was really the outbreak of modern physics. We had the start of quantum mechanics, we had the introduction of relativity, we had the first hints of physics beyond the atom, of subatomic phenomena. And we shouldn't forget that it was really very disturbing. I mean, people actually seriously discussed the possibility that energy conservation was violated in radioactivity. I mean, anything was up for grabs. Now, from the experimental point of view, all of this, of course, focused around radioactivity, ionization, X-rays. So to make quantitative measurements, it was important to have techniques where you could actually measure these things. And the main technique which was used was the detection of the ionization of air in closed vessels. So with what were then called electroscopes, we would now call them, I suppose, ionization chambers. And the design which was mainly used was one developed by an interesting man, a Jesuit, Theodor Wolff. As you may guess from his name, he was in fact German, but he worked in Holland. And again, it's interesting to reflect back, and we forget a lot of history. As a consequence of Bismarck's Kulturkampf, the Jesuits were actually banned in Germany right up to the First World War. So Theodor Wolff, although German, actually had to work in Holland because that was the only place where the Jesuits could officially have colleges and universities. And already, there's a long prehistory on cosmic ray studies, but one important measurement, which everyone mentions, is that in 1909, Wolff got permission from his superiors to travel to Paris. I'm not quite sure how a Jesuit got permission to go to Paris, but anyway, that's another story. And he measured the ionization at the top of the Eiffel Tower, and the bottom of the Eiffel Tower. And indeed, there was less ionization at the top of the Eiffel Tower, but still substantially more than he expected if, as was generally assumed at the time, the ionization was due to radioactive minerals in the ground. So there were clear hints of something strange going on. Here's a picture of Theodor Wolff, and here is his electroscope. His major innovation was to use two quartz fibers, which then made a much more sensitive instrument, which was much more reproducible. Everyone who worked with electroscopes was aware that there was a strange, irreducible background. They never showed zero ionization. No matter how carefully you cleaned them to remove radioactive impurities, no matter how much shielding you used, there was always a strange and somewhat variable background. And it didn't seem to be consistent with any of the known sources of ionization. Certainly Wolf's Eiffel Tower experiment hinted in this way. Perhaps the most important observations were unfortunately not widely known at the time, and some are forgotten about, Domenico Puccini's underwater observations, and we'll hear about those later on today. But the honor for really making the significant breakthrough belongs to Viktor Franz Hess, who in 1912 did what in retrospect seems the obvious thing. He made measurements in a series of balloon flights. But others had done that as well. I have to check this out, but I believe the main reason Hess was more successful than his competitors was he used sealed electroscopes. Earlier experiments had used open electroscopes, and of course then you have the problem that as you go up in the atmosphere, there's less air in your chamber, and therefore you actually cancel out a large part of the signal. He, however, used sealed electroscopes, and he was clearly able to show that the ionization initially decreased as you went away from the Earth, and then started to steadily climb. And he drew the conclusion that the most rational explanation was that there was an ionizing radiation von Seehofer-Dringungskraft, of great penetrating power, incident from above the atmosphere. And the reason he got the Nobel Prize is clearly because he was the first to have the actual courage to clearly and unambiguously state that this signal pointed to an extraterrestrial source of radiation. Even in 1912, he was already linking this to astronomy. He made observations during a nearly complete solar eclipse. He made observations at night. And from that, he deduced that whatever the source of the radiation was, it was not the sun, and that it was therefore coming from even beyond the solar system. And this was obviously a very controversial claim at the time. It was not initially generally accepted. You may hear a bit about the role of the rather unfortunate role of Millikan in all this. But by 1936, it was clearly accepted that Victor Hess was right, and he was recognized with the Nobel Prize in 1936. And had Puccini lived, he would probably also have shared the prize, but that's another story. So this is the famous picture, which all of you have seen many times, Victor Hess after his balloon flight. And there is the data from which he deduced the existence of this, as he called it, Hornstrahlung, which actually is a much better name than altitude radiation than cosmic rays, because they are neither cosmic nor rays. And I believe we will later on have the chance to see this, his original desk, and the electroscopes which he made his discovery. So I'm looking forward to that. Anyway, this discovery was rapidly confirmed by others. Paul Horster in Germany managed to climb to 9 kilometers altitude. Millikan, as I said, was convinced, having initially denied the existence of the radiation, he then had a conversion and decided that they were in fact very high energy gamma rays resulting from nucleosynthesis. And he gave them the unfortunate English name of cosmic rays, which is still in general use. To the extent, actually, that Victor Hess's Nobel Prize was for the discovery of cosmic rays, which was Millikan's name, although it was Hess's discovery. And perhaps all of these early observations were made in manned balloons. This is obviously difficult and dangerous and expensive. A major advance, which is perhaps not as widely recognized as it should be, was by Regner and Futzer in Lindau and Bodensee, who developed automatic instruments which could fly on balloons. And in a way, this was the first of modern balloon-borne cosmic ray experiments, an experimental technique which is still widely used, and which with the development of circumpolar flights has gained new credibility. And they actually got high enough to discover the Futzer maximum in the upper stratosphere. We know now, of course, that the incident cosmic rays penetrate radiation length or so into the atmosphere, then they start initiating a shower of secondary particles, and that means that the actual ionization climbs initially, and then as the shower gradually fades away through the atmosphere, it declines. So this is the famous Futsal maximum in the upper atmosphere. This is a rather nice graphic. You probably can't see it very well at the back, but it gives you a scale. Here is the Eiffel Tower, where Wolf carried out his measurements. Hess's balloon altitude is there. Paul Horster is up there. This gives you some idea of how high in the atmosphere you have to go to really study cosmic rays. Of course, if you go to high enough energies, then the cascade can reach all the way down to sea level. And this was noticed by other people, but was first really documented and studied by the French physicist Pierre Auger. And this then led to the branch of extensive air shower studies, culminating in the Pierre Auger Observatory. So what do we know, or think we know? We certainly know quite a lot now about the mysterious radiation that Hess discovered. We know for a fact that the cosmic rays are mainly stripped atomic nuclei, with some electrons and some secondary particles produced by nuclear interactions in propagation. So there are antiprotons, positrons, and so on. We believe that these secondary antiparticles are almost entirely of secondary origin. There is no evidence for a primary source of antiprotons. Positrons, there may well be a contribution from pulsars. The composition, the chemical composition, where we can measure it, which is mainly at energies of around a GeV per nucleon, and a little bit above that, is rather normal. One has to qualify that a little bit, because first of all, what does normal mean? It's usually taken to mean the bulk composition of the solar system, which is taken as a proxy for the average chemical composition of the galaxy. What is clear is that if you correct for spallation effects, the composition is relatively normal, but the heavy elements, carbon, iron, silicon, etc., are overabundant relative to hydrogen by a factor of about 30. The cosmic rays have certainly traveled through the interstellar medium for quite some time. There's clear evidence of nuclear interactions producing spallation secondaries. Lithium, beryllium, and boron, for example, are very rare elements. They are actually destroyed in stars rather than made in stars. And they are quite common in the cosmic rays because they are produced by spallation of carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen. And in fact, it's quite remarkable. You can go into a chemical laboratory and look at a bottle of beryllium, and every single, as far as we know from standard nuclear synthesis, every single nucleus in that sample of beryllium has been made by a cosmic ray interaction. There is no other way of making beryllium that we know. An obvious thing to do is to look for a signal in terms of arrival directions. If you're an astronomer, this is the first thing you think of. With charged particles, it doesn't work. The arrival directions are extraordinarily uniform. It's isotropic to 1 part in 10 to the 4. This, of course, simply reflects the fact that they're charged and the galaxy is full of magnetic fields, which smooth out and randomize the directions. And perhaps the most startling discovery of all is that the cosmic rays have an incredibly smooth power-law energy spectrum. This is generally called the Simon Swarty plot after our colleague Simon Swarty, who unfortunately died a few years ago, otherwise I'm sure he would have been a participant in this symposium. And you can see that we start down at around a GeV or so. Below a GeV, there are certainly cosmic rays in interstellar space, but we cannot observe them because of the effects of solar modulation and local contamination with solar energetic particles. Above about it, at around a GeV per nucleon or so, the flux is about 1 per square centimeter per second. Very nice for satellite experiments. You can have quite small experiments and make nice measurements with good statistics. As you go up in energy, the flux very rapidly falls. It gets down to 1 particle per square meter per second. There is something that happens at around 3 by 10 to the 15 electron volts. which is called the knee, where this power law seems to steepen a little bit. That is called the knee in the spectrum. The fluxes there are of order one particle per square meter per year. You can already see that this is proving technically challenging. Ideally, you would like to make these measurements in space with the satellite experiment, but satellite experiments cannot be made larger than about a meter squared. And if you're only counting one particle a year, it's not going to work. We can continue with air shower techniques, and we have measured the energy spectrum right up to energies around 10 to the 20 electron volts. And the remarkable thing really is how smooth this spectrum is and how it continues with, if you plot it this way, you really don't see very much structure at all. You can straighten it out a bit, and then you do see clearly that there is a kink at the knee, there's possibly a second knee, there is an angle where the spectrum hardens again at about 3 by 10 to the 18. It is tempting to interpret that as the transition between galactic particles and extragalactic particles. And the amazing thing is that it definitely continues up to around 10 to the 19, 10 to the 20 electron volts. And it's worth noting that nature manages to do much better than the LHC. The LHC, of course, does head-on collisions at 7.5 TeV, but if you translate that into a center of mass for a particle colliding with a particle at rest, once you go above 50 PeV, you're doing better than the LHC ever will. Other things we know. We are now convinced that the cosmic rays fill our galaxy with a somewhat higher intensity towards the center, dropping off a bit as one goes out in the disk. The drop-off is not as much as one would naively expect, and that's an interesting question. But it's clear that there are more cosmic rays in the center of the galaxy than in the outer galaxy. And perhaps the key killer argument, which says that cosmic rays do not uniformly fill the whole universe, as was proposed by Boyle and Burbage, is a test originally proposed by Ginsberg. If you look at the gamma ray emissivity of the Magellanic Clouds, and that is definitely very much lower than it would be were they illuminated by the same flux of cosmic rays that we see in our own galaxy. So clearly, the bulk of the cosmic rays are a galactic phenomenon. The energy density is remarkably high. It's about one electron volt per cubic centimeter, comparable to that of starlight, comparable to the thermal motions of the interstellar gas, comparable to the magnetic field energy density. And this rough equipartition strongly suggests that these components are in fact dynamically coupled and that there is therefore some approximate equilibrium. But you shouldn't take that. Equipartition is a word much invoked by astronomers and much despised by theoreticians. And the source power needed to maintain this energy density is remarkably high. You need something like a few to 10% of the entire mechanical energy input into the galaxy by supernova remnants. Just to show you how we know that the cosmic rays fill the galaxy fairly uniformly, this is a beautiful picture from the Fermi satellite showing the gamma ray emissivity. Well, it's a map of the whole sky, actually, but it's clearly dominated by this diffuse emission from the galactic plane. That results mainly from the decay of neutral clouds produced by the interaction between cosmic ray particles and the gas of our galaxy. And basically what you're seeing here is a map of the product of cosmic ray flux and gas density. And you can clearly see that the galactic center is bright, the galactic anti-center is a bit dimmer, it fits very well. So all of this leads to what in particle physics parlance would be called the standard model. And the standard model, which all of us believe, but which is not absolutely proven, is that the cosmic rays are non-thermal particles accelerated out of the interstellar medium by strong shock winds. Immediate post-shock region in young supernova remnants, the magnetic fields are 150, 200, 300 micrograms, well above what you would expect by just compressing the interstellar field of a few micrograms. And the only plausible explanation is that these are dynamical effects related to the particle acceleration and the shock. And this is important because the higher magnetic fields enable you to accelerate particles to higher energy. And this one additional element seems to be the missing piece in the jigsaw, which fits in and explains, without this magnetic field amplification, we had a problem in that the standard diffusive shock acceleration applied to supernova remnants would get you close to the knee, but not beyond it. Whereas from the observations, you actually need to accelerate in the galaxy through the knee up to somewhere close to the ankle. And this missing few decades of energy appears to be covered by this magnetic field amplification mechanism. So we think we've filled in that bit of the jigsaw. That's a nice, pretty picture, but can you actually test it? And physics is about making predictions which you can verify with observations or experiments. And there are a few observational tests that you can subject this to. One, which at the moment is perhaps the most convincing argument, is basically a very simple energy balance argument. You look at supernova remnants. If you can get an independent estimate of the shock velocity from, say, proper motion studies or spectroscopic data, and you can determine the temperature of the plasma behind the shock, if there was nothing else going on, then of course the temperature is uniquely related to the shock velocity just by simple energy conservation arguments. You take the kinetic energy coming in, you put it into thermal energy, that gives you the temperature. It is clear that these temperatures are far too high in some supernova remnants. The energy is going somewhere else. Some of it could go into magnetic fields, but really the only plausible reservoir into which that energy could go is into accelerated non-thermal particles, which we otherwise don't see. So it's a somewhat indirect argument, but it's quite compelling. There is an argument about the detail of the chemical composition. If this theory is true, then you should be able to at least plausibly explain why the chemical composition is close to normal, but why, for example, things like iron are overabundant relative to hydrogen. An interesting and potentially crucial test is that if supernova remnants are in fact producing the bulk of the cosmic rays, then there will be a substantially enhanced population of cosmic rays inside and around supernova remnants. There is matter there, molecular clouds, ordinary swept up interstellar medium. You can calculate what that should imply in terms of gamma ray visibility. And it is a clear prediction of the theory that at least some supernova remnants should be visible as sources of high energy gamma radiation. And we'll come to that in a minute. Unfortunately, all of these tests are, there is no showstopper, but equally there is nothing that one can point to which absolutely conclusively says we've solved the problem. What would, in some ways, be the smoking gun which we were all hoping for would be the detection of high-energy neutrinos from some supernova remnants, because these can only be produced in high-energy hadronic interactions. This is the Holy Grail. It's very difficult. We are making, however, significant progress. Those of us who were in Innsbruck will recall the beautiful talk by Francis Hals. You can, from X-ray observations, infer the temperature of the shocked gas. And if the thermal energy density of the shocked gas is much less than 15/16 of the kinetic energy density, that strange factor comes assuming that the shock is compressing by about a factor 4, then you know that there is energy going into something else. And that invisible sink of energy is most plausibly cosmic rays with possibly some magnetic field. And there was a paper in 2009 by Evelyn Helder, which claims that they have been able to do this for one specific remnant. And it's actually pretty convincing. There was an earlier, much earlier paper by Jack Hughes in 2000, where he made a rather similar claim for a remnant in the Magellanic Clouds. There, however, the data is not quite as convincing. So that's a very indirect, but if you believe energy conservation, and as physicists we have to, I think, then it's a convincing argument. I mentioned chemical composition. After you make corrections for nuclear interactions as the cosmic rays propagate through our galaxy, you can infer what the composition at the source should have been, and that is basically rather normal. You have all the elements present, usual nucleosynthetic signatures, but it's not completely normal. The heavy and the refractory elements are overabundant by quite large factors, at least 30. And if you actually take this seriously, and remember we have very good high-quality data on the chemical composition of these energies, so this is data that you have to explain. It's clear that you need at least a two-parameter model to fit the data. It's not easy to fit. And I did some work on this a few years ago with Don Ellison and Jean-Paul Meyer in Paris, and we concluded that actually you can make a very plausible, almost ab initio calculation if you say that the interstellar medium is dusty, the refractory elements, calcium, iron, silicon, etc., are for the most part in small dust grains, which under plasma conditions will be charged, then it all gets a little bit, it seems a little bit baroque, but the physics is good. You have these charged grains, they get slightly accelerated in the shock, then they start to sputter. The secondary ions then get picked up and accelerated by the standard process. And you can show that this theory plausibly explains the data, and I am not aware of any other explanation which fits the data. So I take that to be confirmation. I won't explain it in detail, but that is basically says you have two sources. You have volatile species, which are picked up directly from the gas phase with quite a strong mass-dependent fractionation. You have refractories, which are sputtered off grains with a much less strong mass dependence. The interesting one is oxygen, which lies in between these curves. Oxygen and carbon are the two elements which in the interstellar medium are both in the gas phase and in grains. And the fact that those are precisely the two elements which lie between these two bands seems to me to be the smoking gun saying that, you know, there's something true in this. Gamma ray visibility. As I said, if the supernova remnants are accelerating the bulk of the galactic cosmic rays, then there should be detectable levels of high-energy gamma-ray emission from hadronic interactions in the remnants themselves. We should, therefore, see glowing shells of gamma-ray emission from at least some supernova remnants. This is probably my best-known paper, published back in 1993 with my colleagues Felix Aharoni and Heinz Vogt and Hess. Took this beautiful picture of a supernova remnant, and indeed, there in the sky is a glowing ring of gamma ray emission. Now, unfortunately, it turns out that actually it's not, probably a lot of that signal is from electrons and not from protons at all. So, as always in science, it's a little bit ambiguous. This is a bit blurred because it's a screenshot of a slide shown by a rapporteur talk at the Beijing Cosmic Ray Conference.
There's fluorescence detectors. I think we're going to have a talk on Auger later. Do we have one? No. Okay. So here is one of the surface detectors, basically just a large tank of water. This is a design going back to the Havre Park experiment. You basically have a large tank of water with a filter tube in it, and you look for the Drury light pulse as muons go through. These atmospheric fluorescence detectors, which measure the fluorescence yield of the atmosphere as a large air shower comes down, and ideally, you have cases where you can see both the fluorescence yield and the surface. We know that the universe is filled with cosmic microwave background photons with an energy of about 1 million electron volts. The pyrometer mass, as any particle physicist would tell you, is 100 MeV. If you do a Lorentz boost by a factor of 10 to the 11, that will take a millielectron volt photon and turn it into a gamma ray sufficiently energetic to excite the delta resonance and produce pions. And therefore, a proton, res mass 1 GeV, 10 to the 20 EV, as a Lorentz factor of 10 to the 11, and sees the microwave background not as a cold, isotropic 3-degree Kelvin background, but as a beam of high-energy gamma rays coming straight at it, sufficiently energetic to excite the delta resonance. And that means that they rapidly lose energy, and as Kenneth Bryson said, is this the end to the cosmic ray spectrum? The calculation, Virginia reminds me, was originally done by Zepdovich, but published by Zed Zeppelin and Kuzmin at almost the same time as Ken Bryson. So the latest results from the Pierre Roger Observatory do indeed show that the spectrum turns down at roughly the GZK energy, but it actually looks as if nature is once again playing games with us. It may actually be that this is the accelerator running out of steam rather than the classical GZK effect, because the composition of these energies appears to be dominated by heavy nuclei, and therefore this is probably photonuclear disintegration or the accelerator just stopping rather than the classic GZK effect. Jury is still out on that. The arrival directions of these energies are not isotropic, which is good news. There is a weak correlation with the local distribution of matter, but as yet one cannot say that they point to any unique source. And I'll speed up a little here. This is just showing the quality of the data. OJ, the all-particle energy spectrum, turning down above 10 to the 19 electron volts. The arrival directions are clearly not isotropic. There was a lot of excitement when the OJ experiment announced a significant correlation between the arrival directions and active galactic nuclei in the Veron-Chetty-Veron catalog. Once again, nature seems to be playing games with us. This is the history of the significance of that signal. And it started off high, and with time has dropped, but not to the point where it has vanished. So the correlation is now weaker than when it was announced, but it's clear that the arrival directions are not isotropically distributed on the sphere. The argument that they are correlated with local matter still stands, I think, but it's not a strong correlation, and you certainly cannot infer any particular source distribution. So our current state of play is that the highest energies must be extragalactic, can plausibly be accelerated by the same sort of mechanism, shock acceleration, working, I believe, in active galactic nuclei, particularly if you include magnetic field amplification. The statistics are still poor, and of course, OJ is in Argentina. We do not have data from the northern sky. Future, OJ North, telescope array. It's clear that really to make progress, we need larger acceptance. There are interesting possibilities with radio detection of giant air showers. The ANITA experiment is one of these. You could, in principle, look for atmospheric fluorescence signals from a spaceborne mission looking down from above the atmosphere, it's the GEM-USA project, and there are other new ideas floating. I mentioned that ballooning has not gone away. Viktor Hess would be pleased to see that we're still flying balloon experiments, mainly in the Antarctic. There are certain advantages to this. First of all, if you fly during the Antarctic summer, one problem with balloons is that when the sun goes down, the balloon sinks and loses altitude. When the sun comes up, it rises up. And you really want to float at constant altitude. If you do it at the South Pole in the summer, the sun never sets. So that's one big advantage. The other is that there is an incredibly strong and stable vortex going around the poles. And if you have a long duration week, we can now fly balloons which stay aloft for 2 weeks or more. And you can actually launch them from the edge of the ice sheet. They go around the pole, 2 weeks later they come back above head, and you can actually let them go around twice, or sometimes even more. And this has really transformed the field of balloon-borne experiment. John Mitchell showed in Innsbruck some beautiful pictures of what's involved with doing experiments on the Antarctic. I think Viktor Hess would have loved to see that. This is a cartoon, propaganda cartoon from GEM-USO, showing what it might be able to do if it was ever flown. So, if I can conclude, we're close, I think, to solving the mystery that Viktor Hess discovered, but there is still a lot of work to do. I think the message to take away is that the pioneering spirit of Viktor Hess lives on. We are doing experiments, running or planned, for deep underwater, frozen into the Antarctic ice, flying for weeks on stratospheric balloons, covering large parts of the Argentinian pampas, potentially flying on the International Space Station. This, in many ways, is a direct continuation of Viktor Hess's courage in climbing into a hydrogen balloon and going up to 5 kilometers. And I think he would love to have seen all this. If I can conclude with a little epilogue, it's not generally known, but Viktor Hess very nearly worked in Dublin. You have to remember, going back now to the 1940s, the Dublin Institute for Advanced Studies was established in 1940. Schrödinger was working in Dublin from 1939 onwards and was the first head of the School of Theoretical Physics. And there was a proposal to complement the theoretical work with a more observational and experimental section, which was provisionally to be called the School of Cosmic Physics, and was to include a cosmic ray section. And Viktor Hess was approached and asked, would he be interested in being the first head of the cosmic ray section in the School of Cosmic Physics? In the end, this did not come about, nominally because of delays by civil servants, which I can well understand, and a certain lack of clarity about pension rights, etc. Instead, the position went to the brilliant Hungarian physicist, Janosi, who left after a few years to set up the Central Research Institute in Budapest. He was succeeded by Cormac Kakali, and I succeeded Cormac Kakali. So, in some sense, I very nearly am a direct successor of Viktor Hess, but not quite. And if I can conclude, I did discover in the Institute's archives a copy of a letter from Viktor F. Hess of 20 William Street, Mount Vernon, New York, written on May 31st, 1944 to Erwin Schrödinger. And I would like to conclude by just reading this letter. Dear Erwin, thank you for yours airmail, letter of April 29th, which arrived a few days ago. Well, you are wrong in assuming that I would come so soon. I haven't heard from the Consul General of Air in New York for the last 3 months. At that time, I was informed by him that certain points as superannuation, retirement, provisions, also funds for experimental work at the Institute, would require legal action in the Parliament, and this would take quite some time. At the present time, travelling would be also quite difficult, and I am not even sure if we would get passports, although we both are American citizens since last winter. At present, I am not only teaching, but I am also engaged in scientific work valuable for the war effort, and this naturally makes the whole situation more involved. You will understand that I take the offer very seriously, and that I think that it is just the right thing for me if certain conditions can be fulfilled. As soon as the war in Europe is over, and this I think will be within a year, it will be relatively easy to travel to Dublin. So far, I have not informed anyone in the university of the Dublin offer. Things were too vague, and I would have to have more definite information before I could go to the president. Naturally, I am much indebted to the university, since it was they who called me to New York just at the right moment, so that I would get out from my native country. Fermi is not anymore in New York. He is doing more work in Chicago or near Chicago. I will try to reach him through a friend, (Shine), and settle your small debt as requested. You can be assured that I shall keep in touch with the Consul General. It would be premature to set a date. I have to proceed here with consideration and delicacy, since I do not want to offend anybody who treated me so well in the past. I should, of course, very much like to talk things over with you. In the meantime, I should appreciate if you could write me giving me more detailed information about the Institute of Advanced Study, its management, the duties of a senior professor. Would I have an assistant? How about apparatus, lecturing and teaching duties? Your personal impression and judgment also about living conditions, etc., would be most valuable. I wish to thank you also for sending me reprints, which came during the winter. It is gratifying to see that you are now working under so favorable conditions. I cannot send you reprints now. There is much... I can't read that. There's something about sending reprints abroad. I have submitted about 16 papers since 1939. Most of these appeared Terrestrial Magnetism and Physics Review. Two candidates for the PhD are working with me now. I lost my assistant last year, he was drafted. Three doctorates were conferred to pupils of mine in the last few years. We are in good health, generally speaking. My wife had last year a bad intestinal gripper. I had the chickenpox in 1943. We both send our heartiest greetings to you and your wife. Write again, please, as always, yours, Viktor. And as far as I can make out, Viktor Hess was a very honest, decent man with quite conservative views. And how he would have reacted to Schrödinger's menage a trois in Dublin and his politically dodgy past, I wonder whether he really wanted the position. I leave you with that thought. Thank you.